A professor at the New York University School of Law and a fellow at the Hoover Institution, Richard Epstein is one of the nation's leading constitutional scholars and one of its leading libertarian thinkers. Two quotations. The first from President Obama this past summer, quote, middle-class families can't wait for Republicans in Congress to do stuff, meaning I, the president, am going to take action on my own. So sue me. The quotation ends, so sue me, close quote. Senator Ted Cruz, again this past summer, quote, of all the troubling aspects of the Obama presidency, none is more dangerous, than the president's persistent pattern of lawlessness, his willingness to disregard the written law and instead enforce his own policies via executive fiat. And that came, attached to that came a list of 76 instances in which Ted Cruz or his staff identified the moments when the president of the United States had set aside existing law to substitute his own actions.
Only 76?
It may have been 79. I mean, I remember, but yes, but it was under, I did read the list and they all looked pretty plausible to
they
me.
Are.
I think they had them. I think it was a correct list in my judgment. Barack Obama says he's just doing his job and Ted Cruz says he is engaging in dangerous lawlessness. Where's Richard Epstein?
I'm much closer to Ted Cruz on this one than the president. First of all, the president says we can't wait for the Republicans to do stuff, right? The word stuff, it lacks a certain degree of precision. If he means stuff, the stuff that he wants to do, he's only making things worse. And this then, I think, tells us something about the relationship between the distribution of powers on the one hand and substantive outcomes on the other. One of the reasons why we care so much about separation of powers and checks and balances is unilateral actions by single individuals often lead to very serious mistakes. And so if you make sure that the procedures are going to be followed, you may slow things down a little bit, but you're likely to get better outcomes. The president has supreme self-confidence in a set of sort of political propositions, which I regard as economically naive and socially dangerous. And so when he basically wants to go unilateral, we use two ways. We get bad substance and we get bad procedures. It also invites retaliation and imitation by a Republican when he gets into power, where these guys will start to do it. One of the long-term advantages of a system of separation of powers, which also applies, say, to the Senate and Harry Reid and the filibuster, is if you keep all of these things in place in any one term, the other guys will reciprocate. It means that changes in control will be less dramatic in terms of their changes in social outcomes, and you'll get a greater measure of social stability, which is really important. Because what the president does by executive order, a Republican president in 2017 can undo by executive order. And in the meantime, people are trying to figure out how they rely on what's going on today in order to plan their actions tomorrow. And if they know that they could be reversed yet a second time, everybody loses in the uncertainty. And so I think the president has no idea of how reckless his behavior is. And the irony is he keeps complaining about the miserable outcomes, all of which are attributable to his policy. Let me give you one other example. The president was in favor of keeping unemployment insurance at 99 weeks or close to that.
Yes.
And he thought there was no moral hazard. Dream on. Whenever there's a subsidy program, there is always moral hazard. The only question is how much.
You better explain the term moral hazard.
Moral hazard means that if you protect people against certain kinds of risk from dangerous conduct, the consequences of it, they're more likely to engage in the dangerous
thing. You get more of that conduct.
Yeah. So what happens is if you want to protect people from the risks of being unemployed, you'll get more unemployment. And everybody understands it. The question is just how powerful an effect it is. And at 2 days, it's not very formal. 26 weeks, which was the old equilibrium, probably the relief in giving people a chance to get a job, it may be worth it. But once the Democrats found that their bluff was called by the Republicans and they shortened the period, all of a sudden, the recent studies suggest that unemployment rates fell down and employment surged. The moral hazard explanation applies. Moral hazard is not part of his intellectual universe. And if you don't understand that—
And yet he was a colleague of yours at the University of Chicago Law School.
Now, please, he was a senior lecturer, not a professor. And he was, shall we say, an evanescent figure. He taught at the law school, but he never fully engaged in the internal culture, and he certainly never engaged with the law and economics type. And the way you can tell that is words like—
How many times did you have lunch with him?
None while he was in office, but I'm not
and
alone.
And look at the shape the Republic is in.
Well, but I mean, I know him outside of that because his best friend is Marty Nesbitt. For many years, we were neighbors on Woodlawn Avenue, and I would see him through that thing, and I played ball with him and so forth. He's a great guy in those days in terms of his personal ethics. ethic for work and excellence and so forth, but he's never let himself get systematically educated. And what's so extraordinary about him is how little he knows and how confident he is.
You're talking about a man who started his undergraduate education at Occidental, as I recall, which is a fine, certainly very expensive, fine school on the West Coast.
And
then he went to Columbia.
As did I.
As did you. And then he went to Harvard Law School. And you just said, I think this is a direct quotation, he never permitted himself to get educated.
That's right.
What do you mean?
Well, you could go to these places and get the greatest education in the world if you want to, but you have to expose yourself to some systematic discipline. And that means, in effect, it's nice to know a little bit about price theory, nice to know a little bit about ethics, you know, rigorously taught. It's nice to know something about evolution and doing this, nice to know something about game theory. He never, as an undergraduate, was serious about his work, and the evidence for that is he's never released his transcripts, right? And we know why. And at law school, he was, you know, energetic in a political sense in an environment, Harvard 1988 to 1991, where the critical legal studies, the critical race studies were really very important. He imbibed much of that stuff. He comes to Chicago. He works terrifically hard on his biography and so forth, and then on Audacity.
He writes a book.
But it's not the kind of book that you'd write. It's not a poem.
It's not your book on the uncertain quest for a limited government.
I mean, it's just such a complete difference in what it is. And he spent a lot of time being a nighttime politician, which is his choice, spent a lot of time in the assembly, a part of time being in an activist law firm. And what he never developed as president of the United States is a consistent worldview that is capable of sustaining the heavy burdens of domestic and foreign affairs. And so everything is sort of ad hoc.